Alright, so this is Daryl Hill for Comp 2402, video lecture number 2, set to release on March 24th. And today we're going to continue talking about balanced binary search trees. Last class we were talking about scapegoat trees, but before we get into that, let's just sort of review what a balanced binary search tree is and why it's considered to be effective. So operations on a binary search tree are big O of the height of the tree, and so that translates, in generally speaking, into O of N, since there really is no bound on the height, depending on how you constructed your binary search tree. But if you have a run of all the elements in order, and in real life, I mean, getting data in ordered data is not out of the question, so it's very possible to get a tree of height of O of N. Balanced binary search trees have log N height. And how they get that is, what would we mean by balanced is that, generally speaking, for any node, the amount of nodes in its left subtree is approximately equal to the amount of nodes in the right subtree, to within some constant. And so this means that basically the height of the tree is going to be log n, and that means that all of our operations are going to run in O of log n time, since they all sort of depend on the height of the tree. Okay, so that's, so balanced binary search trees are sort of the binary search trees that we prefer. So how can we rebalance them? Well, we can rebuild them, and we saw that last lecture with scapegoat trees. So anytime some part of the tree becomes unbalanced, we simply gather up all the nodes and rebuild it into as balanced as we can get it. There's also rotations, and we will see that later on with red-black trees. And actually, we'll see it a little bit today with treaps, but for a different reason, not to keep it balanced. But we'll see that later. And today we're going to look at randomization. So we're going to look at a random binary search tree, and treaps will sort of be connected to that. That'll be either part of this lecture or next lecture. So, but they're random binary search tree and treaps are related. So random binary search trees and treaps. So what's the ideas behind these things? So let's consider if we take all of the numbers from 1 to 7. And now we're going to, so typically what we want to do is we want to add them to a binary search tree in some order. So how many different orders are there, and what kind of trees do they create? So that's sort of the question that we're going to explore. And so the first part of this question is, how many arrangements exist of 7 numbers? So let's say that we take our 7 numbers, and then we take the first number and we place it in one of 7 locations. All right, so where are we going to put this one? Well, we have 7 possible choices to place the number 1. And so let's say we place it here. And then we're going to go into number 2, and we're going to place it in one of the 6 remaining locations. So let's say that we place it here. And then our number 3, we're going to place it in the 5 remaining locations. So maybe we place it here. So 6 possible choices to place 2, 5 possible choices to place 3, and we can go on and place the rest of our items. And at each successive stage, we have 1 less place to add them. So this goes down to 1 possible choice to place 7. And then, so how many different ways can we arrange these things? Well, 7 choices for the first item, 6 for the second, times 5 for the third, times 4 for the fourth, 3 times 2 times 1, and that is 7 factorial. So 5,040 different ways to arrange the numbers from 1 through 7. So that's quite a few. So let's look at sort of the binary search trees that some of these arrangements will produce. So let's add 1 to 7 in order. So we should know how to add things to a binary search tree at this point. That was last class or the class before. But if we start to add 1 to 7 in order. So we add with 1 first, and so 1 becomes the root of our tree, and next we add 2. And to add 2, we of course follow the search path until we reach a leaf. So 2 goes to the right of 1, and then there's nothing to the right of 1, so we can add 2 as a leaf of 1. Next we add 3, so 3 goes to the right of 1, and then it goes to the right of 2. So that goes here, and next we add 4. Perhaps you see a pattern emerging. 6, 7. So if we add all of these elements in order, we get this list structure. And that's not really a great binary search tree, since the height, as we can see, is O of n. Basically, this behaves a lot like a list. However, one thing to note is that no other ordering will create, no other ordering will create this binary search tree. That's the only one. Well, let's look at some other orderings and look at the kind of binary search trees that they create. So here we have three different orderings, but let's start with the first one. So we're going to add 4 first. So 4 goes at the root of our tree, and next we'll add 2. So 2 is less than 4, so it goes in the left subtree. Next we'll add 1. 1 is less than 4 and less than 2, so it goes into the left subtree of 2. Next we add 3. 3 goes into the right subtree of 2 because it's less than 4 and greater than 2. 6 goes into the right subtree of 4. 5 goes into the left subtree of 6. And 7 goes into the right subtree. So this is a perfectly balanced binary search tree. And this is the sort of thing that we're aiming for when we build these binary search trees. This is sort of the ideal. Okay, so let's look at our next sequence. So we're going to add 4 first. Then we'll add 2. 2 goes to the left. Next we'll add 6. 6 goes to the right. Next we'll add 3. 3 goes to the left. And then at 2 it goes to the right. Then we'll add 5. 5 goes to the right. And then left at 6. 1. And 7. So you'll notice that the second sequence gives us the exact same binary search tree, and it's a perfectly balanced binary search tree. And I'm not going to show you, but you could perhaps convince yourself that this third sequence also produces a balanced binary search tree like this. And so one thing maybe we'll notice is all of them start with 4, so we have 4 as the root. But then for the second number, you can choose either 6 or 2. Because if we add a 2, it's going to go here. And if we add a 6, it's going to go into the right subtree. And so the left and the right subtree are kept separate. Once you decide on your root, then you've basically decided which elements are going into your left subtree and which elements are going into your right subtree. That is well defined. So you can add either 6 or 2. So let's say we add the 2. And now for your third choice of number, any of these three will do. So you could add the 1 next, the 3 next, or the 6 next. So now you have three choices at the for the third one. So that's here, here, and here. On a perfectly balanced binary search tree, as we add things, we end up with more choices that produce the same tree. So there's more sequences, more permutations of these numbers that produce a perfectly balanced binary search tree. And even if it's not perfectly balanced, a random permutation is likely going to produce something that's pretty balanced. So a binary search tree, a couple facts here, a binary search tree on 15 items has one way, one way to produce a list. So that's, if it's 15 items, then the elements 1 through 15 or 0 through 14 will be in a list, as we saw up here. And 21,964,800 orderings that produced perfectly balanced binary search trees. So the odds are in your favor if you choose sequences at random that you're going to get something that's pretty well balanced. And we're going to prove that today. So let's look at, first we're going to define our problem, and then we're going to define our data structure that we're going to use to solve that problem. So our problem is that we have n elements and we want a static data structure that is no, once we've constructed it, there's going to be no add or removes, and it's going to be optimized for search, right? So we want the find operation to happen quickly. So our solution is going to be a random binary search tree. So a random binary search tree adds n elements in random order. That is, any of the n factorial permutations is equally likely, and what that means is that each of them has a probability of 1 over n factorial of occurring. Okay, so that's, so we know how to construct a random binary search tree. It's simple, we shuffle the items and then we add. We know how to add things to a binary search tree. So we saw that last lecture. So how to construct it is pretty well defined at this point. We don't need to go over it. All we have to analyze is this find operation. So we know how to construct it. We don't know necessarily what type of tree to expect. So we're going to prove what type of tree that we can expect. And so in order to prove it, we're going to define this SPX to be the search path for X. So SPX, X is some value in our tree, and the search path for X is we start at the root and we do the find operation until we get to either that the element that we're looking for, or we find a nil node. So before we go through the proof, so the proofs aren't that long, but they're sort of mathy, a little bit opaque in places, but we're going to go through the idea behind it, and the idea behind it is not that complicated. So we consider a random binary search tree built on the numbers from 1 to 10, and then we're going to call find 10.5, and we're going to analyze sort of the expected length of this search path for 10.5 to be. Now, 10.5 does not exist in our random binary search tree, but that's fine. We're still going to look for it until we find a nil node. And it's still a useful exercise in determining how long we would expect a path to be. So another way to think of it is how many elements are on the search path for 10.5. Okay. All right, so let's start with... So we want to call to find 10.5. We're going to assume that we've already constructed our tree, but let's examine how we've constructed our tree. So we've shuffled all the elements from 1 through 10, and then we're going to add them in random order. So let's just choose some random order and see what happens. So let's say that we add 3 first. So this is, this will take a bit to process. This really illustrates the importance of data structures, how long this actually takes to gather up all these things and then shift them one space downward. So as you might have guessed, Microsoft doesn't implement this very efficiently. They use a simple solution, but it's neither here nor there. So this is the construction of our random binary search tree. And the construction consists of 10 calls to add, the first one being add 3. So let's see what happens when we add 3. Well, 3 goes at the root, so no surprise there. And then we want to analyze search path for 10.5. So if we're looking for 10.5, we're going to go into the right subtree of 3. So that's our search path for 10.5. And as we build our random binary search tree, if 3 is the root, now we have to add all the other elements to our random binary search tree. And in particular, we already know which elements will go into the left and right subtrees. So we know that 1 and 2 will go into the left subtree of 3, and we know that 4, 5, 6, up to 10 will go into the right subtree of 3. So what that means is that since our search path goes into the right subtree, 1 and 2, sorry about that, 1 and 2 will never appear on the search path for 10.5. So the fact that we chose 3 means that everything in the opposite subtree of 3 from our search path are things that will never appear on our search path. So this is sort of how our analysis is going to go. As we explore down the tree, we're going to eliminate a lot of nodes with, you know, a high probability at each step. Okay, so that's great. We've eliminated two things from our search path. So let's look at the next step. Let's say our next step is add 7. Actually, no. Let's say we do add 2, add 1. So we have 3, 2, 1. None of those things don't affect our search path for 10.5. We could have added them at any time, but let's get them out of the way. And then the next thing we add is 7. Okay, so 7 is larger than 3, goes into the right subtree. So now, 7 is larger than 3, it goes into the right subtree. So that means that 7 does appear on the search path for 10.5. But now, 10.5, our search path, when it hits 7, it goes to the right of 7 again. So our search path for 10.5 goes to the right. And we have left to add 4, 5, 6, and 8, 9, 10. So 4, 5, 6 go into the left subtree of 7, and 8, 9, 10 will go into the right subtree of 7. So again, we notice that we've eliminated roughly half the items from our search path for 10.5. just by sort of randomly choosing the root of this subtree. So that's sort of the idea behind it, is that at every step, with high probability, we're going to, or on average maybe, we're going to eliminate half of the remaining items from our search path. Okay, so let's prove this now. So what we're going to prove is this theorem. A random binary search tree can be constructed in n log n time, and the find operation takes log n expected time. So if the find operation takes log n expected time, then that's also going to be the bound on our add operation. So as we add n items to our random binary search tree, we get this O of n log n expected time for construction. So basically the time for construction and the time for find both follow from this time for find bound that we have. So this is really what we want to prove, is that find takes O of log n time. And so how we're going to prove that is lemma one. In a random binary search tree, the expected length of any path for x, any search path for x, is the ith harmonic number plus the jth harmonic number plus some constant factor. So where I is the number of items less than x, and j is the number of items greater than x. Okay, so what is a harmonic number? So let's review that for the people who maybe don't remember. So harmonic numbers. So for some integer k greater than 0, the kth harmonic number is 1 plus 1 half plus 1 third plus 1 quarter up to 1 over k. And that's closely related to the natural log of k. So we can express this as I equals 1 to k of I. And right, so it's closely related to the law of k. So that's the natural logarithm. Natural logarithm is log to the base e of some number, which is log to the base 2.78, I think. It's an irrational number, so this keeps going forever. But this is roughly what it is. So what that means is that anytime we see, now let's see exactly how this is related, actually. So the ln of k is less than or equal to I equals 1 to k of I, which is less than or equal to the ln of k plus 1. And what this means is that if we see the harmonic number, if we see the kth harmonic number, we can assume basically that that's log of k. So this becomes O of log of k. So that's how, that's basically how the harmonic number works, and that's as much as we care about it. If we see this sequence here, the summation, we can say that, well, it's O of log of whatever that number is. Okay, so that's the harmonic number. So what that implies then is, if we say the ith harmonic number plus the jth harmonic number, this entire sum is going to be O of log of n. Since this is O of log of n itself, and this is O of log of n itself too, neither, both I and j are less than n. So that's at most 2 log n plus some constant. So we get O of log of n in total. Okay. So we can see that lemma 1, so the theorem follows from lemma 1. That's pretty, the expected length of any search path, well, this is our find operation here. And we've shown that it's, if we believe lemma 1, then we've shown that it's O of log n. We saw why here. So this is going to be important. So let's prove lemma 1 then, and then we're done. We've proven our theorem. So lemma 2, on a call to find x where I is less than x without loss of generality. So this applies to when I is greater than x as well, but it's a symmetric argument. For now, we're just going to argue for I less than x. I is on the search path for x if and only if I was added before all of the elements between I and x, basically. So these are all elements between I and x. And we'll notice that this if and only if statement here means that this is a two-way implication. So we have to prove one here. So if I was added before all of the numbers between I and x, then I is on the search path for x. And we also have to prove if I is on the search path for x, then I was added before all of the elements between I and x. So we have to prove both of these things. And to help us prove it, we're going to look at, we have this quick little observation here. So if I was added before the elements between I and x, since we followed the search path for I to, in order to add I, that means none of these elements are on the search path for I. Right? What that means in general is that anything that's not in the tree, when a particular element is added, well, those things can't appear on the search path for that element, right? Because they're not in the tree. They weren't in the tree when it was added, and they can't be squeezed in there later. At least not with this binary search tree. So we'll use that in a minute, and then. So first we're going to prove if I was added before all of the elements between I and X, then I is on the search path for X. And to prove this, we're going to prove by contradiction. So thus we're going to assume that I was added before the elements between I and X, but we're going to say that I is not on the search path for X. And what that implies is that the search path for I and the search path for X split at some node K. And in order for it to split at some node K, K has to be between I and X. So So we know that I is less than, we know that I is less than X. So any element that splits the search path for I and X has to be in between them. So I would go into the left subtree of K, and X would be, or the search path for X would be in the right subtree. But that means that K is one of the numbers between I and X, and K is on the search path for I. But we assumed that I was added before all of these elements, and in particular, that means that I was added before K, and that means that if K is on the search path for I, this is a contradiction to observation one. So we've effectively proven the first part of our proof, that is, if I was added before the elements between I and X, then I is on the search path for X. Okay, so next we're going to prove the second part of our proof here, the implication that goes the other way. And what we state there is that if I is on the search path for X, then I was added before all the elements between I and X. And again, we will prove by contradiction, thus we assume that I is on the search path for X, but there is some subset S of the elements between I and X that was added before I. So we're going to say that K is the minimum element of this subset S. So if K is on the search path for I, then I is not on the search path for X, since S, the search path for I and the search path for X would split at K. So K is between them, and we can see here that I would go down into the left subtree of K, and the search path for X would go into the right subtree of K. But our assumption that we made is that I is on the search path for X, so thus we're going to assume that K is not on the search path for I. All right, so observation one says that, well, K was added before I, that means that I cannot be on the search path for K. So that means neither I is not on the search path for K, and K is not on the search path for I. That means the search path for I and the search path for K must split at a vertex that we will call J. And it must be that J is between I and K, since in order to split I and K, J has to be between them. So I would go into the left subtree of J, and K would go into the right subtree. But that means that J was added before I, and thus J is a member of the subset S. So this is the subset that was added before I. So the subset of the elements between I and X that was added before I. And it also means that J is less than K, which is a contradiction to K being the minimum element of S. So again, by contradiction, we approve the second part of our implication. And that means that we've almost shown lemma one. We've shown lemma two. So lemma two is necessary to show lemma one. All right. So lemma two just states that if I is on the search path for X, I is on the search path for X if and only if I was added before all of the elements between I and X. Okay, so then we want to use that to prove where are we? We want to use lemma 2 to prove lemma 1. So we want to show that this lemma 2 here implies lemma 1. So how do we do that? Well, we're going to, of course, since this is a random binary search tree, we are going to use probability and expected value. So we basically proven that I is on the search path for X if and only if I was added before all the elements between I and X. Since all the elements are in random order, each of the elements from I to the element just before X is equally likely to be added first. Thus, I was chosen first out of this set with probability 1 over X minus I plus 1, which is the number of items in this set, when I is less than X. And symmetrically, if I is greater than X, then I is added before the ceiling of X plus 1, all the way up to I minus 1, or down to, up to I minus 1, with probability 1 over I minus X plus 1. So now we know the probability that any element I is on the search path for X. So we can use the expected value to determine the expected number of nodes on the search path for X, which brings us back to lemma 1. So here is lemma 1 repeated. So to prove this, we're going to use an indicator random variable. Yes, so I subscript I is 1 if I is on the search path for X and it's 0 otherwise. So that's quite simple, and we're just going to sum up the value of this indicator random variable. So our expected number of nodes on the search path for X is equal to the expected value of summing up all of our indicator random variables for all the elements. I equals 1 to n, or 0 to n minus 1. And we can split that up into two different summations. So I equals 0 to the floor of X plus I equals ceiling of X plus 1 to n minus 1. I of I. And then we can use linearity of expectation to break that down into I equals 0 to floor of X, the expected value of I to the I plus and so now this expected value and this expected value is simply the probability that we find this element on the search path. So we sum up all those probabilities, we get alright, so those are two probabilities that we figured out before based on our lemma 2. And then we sum all of these up, we get 1 half plus 1 third plus 1 quarter up to 1 over X plus 1 plus 1 half plus 1 third plus 1 quarter 1 over N minus X. And you'll notice that this sequence and this sequence is the harmonic number minus 1. So the harmonic number starts at 1. So what we end up getting is h to the floor of x plus hn minus ceiling of x minus 2. And that's basically equivalent to our hi plus hj plus O of 1 that we defined before. Okay, so this proves, given lemma 2, this proves lemma 1 here. So that's it. So our random binary search tree has expected height of O of log n. And so that's interesting, although the random binary search tree is sort of limited in its application because it is a static data structure. So next we want to look at something that's not static, and that will be Treaps. All right, so just before we get into Treaps, let's see. So this was to be your assignment 4 until we switched to the easier version. One of the things that you can do here is you can, so there's different types of trees. So there's a complete binary tree. So these are binary trees, they're not binary search trees, but I did implement a random binary tree that is structurally the same as a random binary search tree. So here you can get sort of a sense of what it might look like. So this is a tree on 50 nodes, and you can see that it's, you know, it has some weird shapes to it, but it's still pretty shallow on average, and not that much more than the complete binary tree, a little bit more. All right. So let's talk about Treaps. So random binary search trees are a static data structure. And what that means is that adding and removing, if we allowed that to happen, could destroy the randomness. So it would ruin the distribution, and then we may not get our log n guaranteed. So in particular, some stretches of data might be in order or otherwise have some non-random distribution that ruins our random binary search tree. So then the question becomes, how do we implement the sorted set interface, that is add, remove, and find, and still keep the expected height of a random binary search tree? So that's our goal. And to do that, we use a treat. So it's a combination of a binary search tree and a heap, which we cover later in the course. The nice thing about a treat is that it has an identical distribution to a random binary search tree, even with add and remove, and even if all the items are added in order. So none of that matters. It still behaves and looks exactly like a random binary search tree. And what that means is that the expected height is going to be O of log of n, as we just showed. Okay. Treaps implement the sorted set interface, which is find, add, and remove, but still obtain a O of log n expected search time. And the search time is basically, so each of find, add, and remove uses this search algorithm where it goes down the tree. So that means that all of these methods are O of log n. So let's look a little bit into the details of how we build this. So a node in a treep has data, but it also has a priority P that's assigned at random. So we can see here, these are the, this is a binary search tree node, and we can see that we've taken the binary tree node and we've added this data element. And then we do basically the same thing for a treep node. We extend the binary search tree node and we add this priority element. It's just an integer and it just indicates a priority. And so then how a treep operates is it maintains two properties. So the first property it maintains is on data, it maintains the binary search tree property. So this should be very familiar with you. Basically all the data in the left subtree of a node U is less than U of X, and all the data in the right subtree is greater than U of X. That's the binary search tree property. On the priority, it maintains the heap property. So on data, it maintains the binary search tree property. And on priority, it maintains the heap property. So our priority is this P. So what that means is that at every node U, except for the root, the priority of the parent is less than the priority of the node itself. All right, so here's an example of it. We'll see that our data is highlighted in blue and the priority is highlighted in P. So each node now has two values associated with it. So the data here, 3, and then everything in the left subtree of 3 is less than 3, so that's 1, 0, 2, and everything in the right subtree is greater than 3, and you can quickly convince yourself of that. But it also, so that's the binary search tree property. But also has the priority, and this is the heap property. So what you'll notice about the priority is that, the priority of this, of the root, is less than the priority of its two children. And that's basically the heap property. And in fact, given the recursive nature of trees, that implies that the priority of the root has the smallest priority in the entire tree. So the node with the smallest priority is the root. And this is extended into any subtree as well. So the root of a subtree has the smallest priority in that subtree. And we can see an example of that. So here the priority, if we look at this node here, priority is 11. It's less than 14, 17, 22, 42, and 49. So it's less than everything in that subtree. So that is the heap property. So let's now look at what happens if we're going to use the binary search tree add. So we're going to add 10 using the binary search tree add. So all we do is we compare 10 to 3. And 10 is greater than 3, so we go into the right subtree. 10 is greater than 5, so we go into the right subtree. 10 is greater than 9, so we go into the right subtree of 9. And we've added 10 here. And then when we created this node, we assigned it a priority at random, and let's say that priority was 5. So let's put that here with priority 5. Chosen at random. And let's even make that explicitly clear. Okay. So we've added this node, but so you'll notice when on the add, we use the add method from the binary search tree, so we maintain that binary search tree property, but now we're violating the heap property since 17 is greater than 5, so that's not allowed. So we need some way of restructuring our tree such that we maintain the binary search tree property, but that we can fix our heap property. Alright, so to fix the heap and to maintain the binary search tree property, we use rotations. So it's local restructuring without violating the binary search tree property. So we talked a little bit about rotations and how we would see them as a way to maintain a balanced binary search tree. So here, this is, we'll see how it helps us maintain this balanced property. But first we'll look at what a rotation is. So we have a node U and a node W, and we have the right subtree of U, which could be something, it could be nothing, it could be nil, or it could be something very large. And we have the right subtree of W and the left subtree of W. So now we're going to perform a right rotation at U. And so we're going to say rotate right U. So this would be also the method call that we make. So then what happens? So we have here a parent P of U. And what we want is we want to move W up to U's position. And we want to move, U down into the right subtree of W. So let's see what that looks like. So if we have our parent node P, so W is going to move up into U's position, and U is going to be the right subtree of W. Now, our C is fine. That can stay where it is. And the left subtree of W can stay where it is. That's the A. But W had a right subtree called B. But now U is the right subtree, so we're going to attach B to U's left subtree. So that's called a right rotation at U. And then if we want to go from, so that's rotate right at U. And we can also do a left rotation, and it's basically symmetrical. So rotate left at W will take us from this tree to this tree, subtree. All right, so that means that W goes down here. U becomes the child of P, and W becomes the left child of U, as we can see over here. So rotate right, rotate left. And if you look on Wikipedia, if you look at tree rotations, they have some good animations of that as well. So you can see exactly what's happening. And you'll notice too that, well, everything in U's subtree, if we look over here for a second, everything in U's left subtree is less than U, and that includes this subtree B. So everything in B is less than U. So when we put B as U's left child over here, we're still maintaining the binary search tree property. And still, this subtree B is still in W's right subtree. Right, so nothing gets violated. So this rotation is one way to restructure our tree without violating the binary search tree property. So how does that help us? Well, and this is in general what we do. It's a little more complicated than that, but that's just the basics of it. And this is what we talk about. So in particular, the important thing to notice is the depth of U is increased by 1. The depth of W is decreased by 1, right? So W moves up 1, as we can see here, and U moves down 1, as we can see here. So that means if U and W's priorities violate the heap property, that is U of P is greater than WP, where P is priority, a rotation at U will fix that. That means we can essentially bubble up a node that violates the heap property. Okay, so we can bubble up a node that violates the heap property. So now let's describe and analyze the add, find, and remove on a treap. So first of all, all of these operations depend on the length of the search path in a treap. And our claim is that the expected length of any search path in a treap is O of log n. And we're going to do that by showing that it's exactly a random binary search tree, but we're going to do that later. For now, we want to state this so that we can properly analyze our find, add, and remove operations. So first of all, the find x is the same as the binary search tree. We do the exact same operation, which means it's O of the height, and which means according to lemma 1, it's O of log n. So that's simple. We don't need to do anything further for that. Next, we want to look at the add x operation. So what do we do on an add x? We make a new node. That's perfectly normal. We assign the value. That's also perfectly normal. But now we also assign a priority at random. And then we add it in the normal way. And then after we're done that, we call the bubble up function. So the bubble up simply, as we described, rotates. If the heap property is violated, then we bubble the node up until it's no longer violated. So we'll see that here. So we call bubble up on a node U. First of all, if the parent is nil, we can't rotate up, so we check that. And the other thing we check is if the heap property is being violated. So if the priority of the parent is greater than the priority of our node U, then we take a look at if we're the right child of the parent or the left child of the parent, and we rotate appropriately. All right, so if we happen to be the right child, then we rotate left, and we happen to be the left child, we rotate right. And then at the end, we just check if our parent is nil, that means we are the root. So we assign the root, we assign u to the root variable. So you can see an example of that here. If we add, so this is our treep, so the priorities are on the right, the values are on the left. So if we add our 1.5, it gets added in the same method as a binary search tree. And then once we've done that, we have to call the bubble up method. And the bubble up method checks the priority. So the priority here is 4. The priority of the parent is 99, so it's going to bubble up. So it's going to do, since we are the left child, it's going to do a rotate right. So 1.5 will go up and 2 will go down. And that's what we can see happened here. So 1.5 went up, 2 went down, and then we check again the priority of the parent. In this case, it is still greater than our priority. So we're going to rotate up again. Since we are the left child, we are going to rotate, or since we are the right child, we're going to rotate left. So 1 will go down and 1.5 will go up. And now we can see that 4 is a priority. It's less than the parent, and the heap property is maintained throughout this tree. So we're done. That's the bubble up operation on an add. All right, so the analysis, well, add is bounded by the height of a tree, which we claimed is identical to the random binary search tree. Thus, we get O of log n for add plus the bubble up. Each time a rotation is performed, the depth of U decreases by 1. Thus, there's at most O of the height, which is O of log n rotations. And each of these rotations is a constant amount of work. Right. So that means our add operation is O of log n. So now let's look at our remove. So in remove x, we want to find x in a node U, and then rotate U down into a leaf and splice U from the tree. So splice is simply the binary search tree splice. So once it's a leaf, we can safely just cut it out of the tree. But we do have to be careful rotating it down, because on the way down, we do not want to violate the heap property. So there's a few simple rules for that. So if U has no children, then it is a leaf, so we're safe to splice it out of the tree. If U has only a left child, then we want to rotate right at U. And if U has only a right child, then we want to rotate left at U. That makes sense. That's really the only way that it, otherwise you're going to rotate a nil node up into your treep. And if U has two children, if U.left.priority is less than the right priority, we want to rotate right. Otherwise, we want to rotate left. So what that means is that essentially we want to take the child with the least priority, and we want that child to take our place so that we do not violate the heap property. So let's take a look at an example here. Let's say we wanted to remove X. So this is the one we're going to splice out. We're just going to see what happens if we don't do this properly. So let's say we rotated left. That means Z comes up into X's spot and X goes down. So that's what we have here. And we can see that as we rotate, of course, the priority of X is going to temporarily be out of place until we splice it, but that's fine. X has only a left child, so we want to rotate right at X. So now we are here. So our X is down in a leaf, and now we can call splice X. But now, since we rotated the Z up instead of the Y, we violated the heap property. So we don't want to do that. We want to rotate the child with the least priority up. So here's the correct way. If we call the remove on 9, and the priority of 17, so here we can see so that's the heap property is violated, so that's the wrong way. Let's check out the right way. So we want to remove X. So we call rotate right on X because the priority of Y is less than the priority of Z. So now we end up here. Now X only has a right child, so we want to rotate left at X. And that brings us to here, and now X is a leaf, so we splice X out of the tree, and that brings us to here, and we can see that the priority of Y is less than the priority of Z, and the heap property is maintained. So then, to look at the code a little bit, remove X, so we find, we start by finding X, and then if we found something and that something is what we wanted, so we do have to check this since this is the sorted set interface. It's possible it returns something that's not necessarily equal to what we wanted. It could be the return the least value y that's greater than or equal to x. So if it is the thing that we want to remove, we can trickle down until it's at a leaf, splice you out of the tree, and return true. So we just saw an example of how to do that. And this is the code for trickle down. It's essentially all the things that we talked about. I'm not going to go into the details. They are just, it's a little bit tedious, but it's all very straightforward from the rules that we outlined. Okay, so then the last thing is to analyze remove. One thing we want to notice is that the remove is the opposite of add. So what does that mean? That means if we call add X, it assigns it to a node U, and then it will bubble U up until it's in its correct priority, right? So it follows the search path for X all the way, every rotation, it maintains the binary search tree property. So at every step along the way, it is still a binary search tree and until it reaches its proper height. If we call then remove X, it will first find X in the node U, and then it will perform the reversal of each rotation that we did during the add operation until U is down to the leaf where we initially added it, and then it'll splice U from the tree. All right, so that means that our trickle down is going to be the same runtime as our bubble up, which is going to be O of log n. Thus, remove x equals find x plus trickle down, and all of those are O of log n. Okay, so now the last thing we want to do is we want to show that our lemma 1 is true. So the expected length of any search path in a treep is O of log n. Notice this. A random binary search tree is made by adding n elements in random order. Now consider a treep on n items. If we take these n items and we add them to a binary search tree in order of their priority, we get exactly the same tree as our treep. Right? Does that make sense? So the lowest priority is the first added, and that becomes the root. And that's true of the treep. As we talked about, the lowest priority is always the root. And then that definition is recursive. So the root decides, based on the binary search tree property, which items go into the left subtree, everything that's less than the root, and which items go into the right subtree, that's everything that's greater than the root. So once you decide the root, you've already decided which items will go into the left subtree and which items will go into the right subtree. So now if we look at all the elements in the left subtree, the lowest priority is added first. And that means that that lowest priority in the left subtree becomes the root of the left subtree. And the same is true of the right subtree. Since the priorities are chosen at random, treaps are always shaped like a random binary search tree on n items. And thus the expected length of a search path is O of log n. Right? Hopefully that makes some sort of sense. If not, you can, talk about it on the forums or email me or what have you. So that's it, our treaps and our random binary search trees. So hopefully that's not too long, but next class we will talk about 2-4 trees, which is another type of, it's a balanced binary search tree, but now we balance it using rotations. Similar to what we saw here, but a little bit different, as we'll see. Okay.